Hello, now to look at our sorting algorithms. We have three in this course. We'll focus on bubble sort in this video, but let's just start by clarifying what exactly a sorting algorithm does. Maybe it's obvious, maybe it's not obvious. The purpose of a sorting algorithm is to put a data set into order. And typically the ordering is either numerical or alphabetical, either ascending or descending. Ascending means smallest to biggest, descending is biggest to smallest. Why are we learning this? Well, first of all, we come across sorting quite a lot on different web pages, different programs. Here is a snippet of ASOS, a Clover's website, where we can sort the cloves based on these different categories. Recommended, we'll be using a sorting algorithm, but using some kind of hidden ranking, which we can't see. But what's new, price high to low and price low to high are all ranking based on numerical order. What's new and high to low are descending numerical order. What's new based on the date and low to high is ascending numerical order. So we as humans like to keep things sorted. That's why these are important. But also we learned how binary search is a lot faster than linear search. But binary search has to have our data set in order to be able to make use of its speed. So we might want to sort our data so it can be used with binary search further down the line. Now, bubble sort is one of our standard algorithms for how to sort. Searching, we only really have linear and binary, but there are quite a few different sorting algorithms. I learned maybe about 8 or 9 at university. They all have pros and cons, all have slightly different methods for putting the data into order. Bubble sort works based on multiple passes through the data set. So a pass is a single movement from left to right. And during a pass, we work left to right and we swap pairs if they are not in order. So we look at two items at a time and we swap them if they're not in the correct order. And we keep completing multiple passes until one of these passes completes with no swaps. We can look at a list of items and tell if it is ordered or not. A computer doesn't just know if it is ordered, but in bubble sort, if it completes a pass where nothing is swapped, it knows it's ordered, therefore it can stop. Now, the name of bubble sort is inspired by something like a fizzy drink, where the bubbles are always rising to the top. In bubble sort, assuming it's in ascending numerical order, the numbers which are biggest are always going to rise to the end. So it's not really rising to the top, it's more rising to the right-hand side. The biggest item always in a pass will go towards the end. And we'll see this in action now. Because let's have a look at how we can actually perform bubble sort. It's a common exam question. They can give you numbers, they can give you letters, they can give you words, which is always a bit annoying. But we have to put this data set into ascending numerical order. Make sure you read the question carefully. Don't get caught out. Now, how should we do our workings out here? Well, we, like I say, have multiple passes in bubble sort. So I would always, on the left-hand side, write down the pass and its number. So we usually have at least 2 passes, if not 3 or 4 in an exam question. These could be, 4 marks, 5 marks. It could be a fairly chunky question. So we need to go through this list left to right and swap pairs if they are not in order. Now, I would always advocate doing quite a lot of writing for bubble sort, I'm afraid. Some people try and minimize what they're writing down. I prefer to be really careful and sort of write down quite a lot each time. So looking at our first two items, 15 and 13 are not in order. 13 should be before 15. So therefore I need to swap 13 and 15. And to demonstrate that I've swapped the two, I'm gonna circle 13 and 15. Now, this is where possibly the method I'm showing you is a little bit annoying, because I would then suggest writing down the rest of your list. You might try and kind of move on to the next step at this stage and try and do the next swap. But actually, I think it's confusing. You might make mistakes. So looking at the next two pairs, we've got 15 and 19. Well, 15 and 19 are not out of order. They are in order. So I don't have to swap 15 and 19. And you can save time here by not circling these two because they're not getting swapped. I would only circle a pair if it is being swapped. 15, 19 are fine. 19, 20 are fine. However, 20 and 16 are not fine. 16 needs to go before 20. I'm going to swap the two. And I'm going to circle to demonstrate that I have swapped these two items. I would always copy out my remaining items just for clarity. And this demonstrates a single pass being completed because I've reached the end. I've got no more items to have a look at. I've reached the end, and it's not the best example here, but 20 was our biggest item and it's kind of bubbled towards the end. Biggest item always makes its way up to the end. So now the second biggest item is 19. And we'll see in our second pass, 19 will make its way up to 20. So 13 and 15 are perfectly fine. I don't have to swap these two. 15 and 19 are perfectly fine. I don't have to swap these two. However, 16 and 19 are definitely not fine. They need to get swapped. So I write them down, I circle, and for my own completeness, I fill in my remaining gaps. Now 19 and 20 don't need to get swapped, so I don't have to do anything with those two. And I've completed another pass. And we can see this is now in order. So this is now an ordered list. However, the computer doesn't know this. So the computer always has to do a final pass where nothing gets swapped. In terms of how you demonstrate this, you can just copy down the list itself without any circling. That is representing it not having swapped any of our items. Therefore, it knows it is sorted. Therefore, the bubble sort is completed. Now, I've picked a deliberately kind of simple example as a first one. This list was not massively out of order in the first place, which is why it completed relatively fast, but it can be a bit more tedious. Let's look at a slightly more dramatic example. So this time around, I want to put this data set into descending order. Perhaps pause it and have a go. Don't forget to read the question and pick up the word descending here, not ascending. So let's do my first pass and looking at 5 and 9. Well, 5 and 9 are out of order. If it's descending, 9 needs to come before 5. So I swap them, I circle it, and I copy down the rest of my list. I now look at 5 and 2. 5 and 2 are okay, but 2 and 14 do need to get swapped. Now looking at 2 and 19, well again, 2 and 19 have to get swapped. And finally, looking at 2 and 4, well, unfortunately again, 2 and 4 have to get swapped. I can tell already it's going to take a few more passes here, so I've decided to give myself a bit more space. Let's enter our second pass now. And you'll be really, really careful. If it is a longer question to have to do, you've got to just try and go through it slowly. Often the sort of strongest GCSE students mess up on bubble sort because they try and go too fast. Take your time, go for it really, really slowly. So 9 and 5 are now fine. 5 and 14 have got to get swapped, however. So 5 goes after 14. I circle and I copy down the rest of my list. 5 and 19 have to get swapped. 5 and 4 are fine, and 4 and 2 are fine. We can see in our first pass, our smallest item this time bubbled towards the end, and now 4, our second smallest item, also bubbled towards the end in this pass, although it was actually already there. But anyway, let's enter our third pass, where 14 goes to the first position, and 19 goes to the second position. 9 and 5 are okay, 5 and 4 are okay, and 4 and 2 are okay. So pass 3 has been completed. Let's just move to the right-hand side here. So 19 is now in the first position, which is a good sign because we can see it's the biggest item in our list, so it should be in the first position. We then copy the rest. And now we can see this list is sorted. I've got no more swaps to do in the fourth pass. However, the computer won't know this is the case, so therefore there will always be an extra pass to what we would expect potentially, where it just has to go through each item. And if it doesn't need to swap anything, it therefore must be sorted. So to be honest, I didn't really need all of this space on the right-hand side, but we finished it after pass 5. And let's finish by looking at some potential bubble sort code. How could you tell this is bubble sort when you're given a massive chunk of code like this? Well, bubble sort needs to have nested loops to be able to work. So here in the code, I've got a while loop. I've also got a for loop inside this while loop. That's nesting. Nesting is when I've got a structure inside another structure. I've also got an if statement nested within this for loop, nested within this while loop. So I've got lots of nesting going on, but I've got two loops together. You might have two for loops, but here I've got an outer while loop. Another key thing to look out for is a temporary variable, usually called temp, but not necessarily called temp. This is needed to swap items. So you can see this if statement is checking to see if the item at index I is bigger than the item at index I plus 1. Is the item to the left bigger than the item to the right? Assuming we're putting it into ascending order, if it is, we need to swap those two items around. These three lines are how we do that. Okay, so why do I need to have this temp variable? Well, let's say we're looking at the end of this data set where I need to swap 20 and 16. Well, if I didn't have temp, how would I do this? I might go something like data set index I plus 1, which let's say is 4 in this case. Data set index 4 is now going to be equal to dataset index 3. Well, that means the 16 gets replaced with 20. So 20 moves here, which is what I want. I want 20 to move into position 4. However, the next line would be something like dataset index 3 is equal to dataset index 4. That's the second half of this swap. The problem is dataset index 4 is now 20. and index 3 is already 20. So I can't swap, I've lost 16. In the process, I've managed to delete 16 by trying to do this swap. We can't just swap it like this. We have to make sure I have a temporary variable to save the value from being overwritten when I try and do the swap. Me assigning it to temp means that I can then use it later to restore that value, which in the example was 16. And the last thing to keep an eye out for in Bulbasaur code is a variable which keeps track of whether a swap has occurred in a pass. I said that it doesn't know that it's finished until it completes a pass with no swaps. And we've got here an isSorted variable, which initially is set to false. When we enter a pass, I'm optimistic and I set this to be true because I'm hoping that I'm not going to have to make any swaps. This code here, the for loop, is representing a single pass. We can see that if I do have to make a swap, I then set isSorted to be false. So if it manages to complete a pass without having to run this if statement, therefore it must be sorted because it hasn't got to do any swaps. So while loop keeps looping while isSorted is false. As soon as we complete a pass with no swaps, while loop doesn't run and our program ends. So in an exam, they'll be asking you to perform bubble sort, but also potentially recognize it in code or explain a couple of key aspects of the code. In terms of you practicing programming, if you're confident, maybe have a go at this yourself, give yourself a day or two to forget what I've talked about and see if you can program it from memory.